Brothers, sisters, comrades and friends, assalamu alaikum. The hour is late and the audience depleting, so I shall be brief. A number of things emerged from the extraordinary testimony that we've been listening to this evening at this outstanding, memorable, historic meeting, for which we must thank the Palestine Solidarity Campaign for organizing, because all of us will remember this night. All of us will remember what we heard here. A number of things emerged for me. The first was the extraordinary stoic bravery of the people that were on board those ships and the people that are in this room and that spoke to us this evening. And we salute all of them. Even humor, in the face of such an atrocity, was brought to us by our young brother who spoke last from the survivors. And it was really transformative, I think, to our mood and our approach to this, that every single one of those people is ready to do it again and is asking you to do it again. And I'll come later to a couple of the efforts to do it again in which I'm involved. The second thing that emerged, it's not the second most important thing, but it is a thing that has emerged from virtually every piece of testimony. The rank, craven, pitiful excuse for a diplomatic service that the British Foreign Office represents. When the consul of Macedonia can come at 7 in the morning and come back at 4 in the afternoon, and Her Britannic Majesty's representative in Israel doesn't turn up at all, should be a mark of shame on the British Foreign Office. And I hope every one of us will run that point home to our own members of Parliament. And it's not the first time that they have been responsible for this pitiful level of service to British citizens. Kevin Ovenden, my comrade, who is in Beirut for the International Committee on the Breaking of the Siege of Gaza tomorrow, which will be discussing the next stage in the campaign, had an encounter with the British consul. It seems that he met some Britishers, but not others. And there's beginning to be a pattern of the ones that he didn't meet. Ones with beards. Ones called Muhammad or Ali or Fatima. Or who looked like they might be called Fatima. Seems to be the emerging pattern. But Kevin asked the consul to ask the Israeli guard for something in relation to his stolen property. The consul asked, the guard asked him, told him to get stuffed, and exactly the words that were quoted from one of the speakers earlier, the consul said, well, that's Israel, they do what they do, what can we do about it? Well, as Lindsay German said, we have to undertake a comprehensive review in this country of our relations with Israel. We should withdraw our ambassador for consultations. We should require the departure of the Israeli ambassador, and we should review all diplomatic relations with Israel because of the way that they have behaved to our own citizens, as well as the great crimes, far greater, that they are committing and have committed against the Palestinian people. The third thing that emerged, and I hope it was all caught on video, as it came from all these different people and different kinds of people who were on different boats, is the sheer barbaric nature of the Israeli state. Norman Finkelstein's remark, which was quoted earlier, is, I think, the most apt. Israel is a terrorist state. It is a rogue state. It is a criminal state. But above all, it's a lunatic state. Only lunatics would behave in such a manner and expect to get away with it. And now a number of people have said, the young woman Alex said, that they, of course, have gotten away with much. But it's my view, and I said this at the demonstration on Saturday, that Israel has been spending its political capital in the world with reckless abandon. Quite leave aside the 35 years that I've been involved in this campaign. Let's just look at 2006 till now. With the invasion of Lebanon, with the invasion and the mass bombardment of Gaza, with the murder in Dubai using stolen passports from friendly countries, with the insult to Vice President Biden whilst he was standing there, proud as punch as a lifelong Zionist. They slapped him across the face in what Secretary Clinton described as a grave insult to the United States. Netanyahu's conduct in the White House when the president actually walked out of his own office, leaving Netanyahu sitting there saying, "Call me if you have something to say." And now this. Above all, now this. Because although Israel has committed hundreds of massacres of Palestinians, although Israel has massacred tens of thousands of Palestinians, somehow, and for reasons which we can all, I think, in our hearts understand, the attack on international citizens, on international waters, on their way to deliver humanitarian aid, has, I believe, made a watershed moment, a turning point that we must seize, as Bernard said with such energy just a few minutes ago, and use to bring about the kind of changes that I think we can, and certainly that we must. It's true, you can look at whether the glass is half full or half empty. I did a one-hour show on Al Jazeera last night in which the presenter said, but the United States is two-faced. It's speaking with forked tongue on this affair. And of course it is. But the United States being two-faced is an advance on what they used to be, which was unequivocal supporters of everything that Israel did. It's true also that Alistair Burt, who happens to be, at least was, the chairman of the Conservative Friends of Israel, you've got to be a member of the Friends of Israel to get that job in the Foreign Office, in fact. If you look back at the last, certainly 10, in my experience, including Labour ones, you have to be in the Friends of Israel to get the job as minister with responsibility for Britain's relations with the Middle East. It's true, of course, that Alistair Burt did not say all that we would wish him to say. It's true also that David Cameron did not say all that we'd wish him to say, or William Hague. But they said a damn sight more than David Miliband and Tony Blair and Gordon Brown would have done. I'm absolutely sure about that. I say that not because I'm glad they're in. I'm not. I say that not because I think they mean it. They don't. I say that because they're saying that because of public opinion that we have played a big part in beginning to move. Now, it's true that we have not got yet the international investigation into this crime. But we do have the United States saying there must, they said it this evening, maybe Bernard didn't catch it, probably in here in this meeting. They said this evening that there must be an international element to this investigation if it's to have a shred of credibility. Not enough, but much more than any US president has said before. And again, only because public opinion is pushing him in that direction. The EU is demanding an international investigation, and the Security Council too has said that a purely Israeli investigation will not be credible. That by implication means that there will have to be an international element in it. We must keep up the demand. This was an international crime in international waters against international citizens, and there must be an independent international inquiry into it, and we will accept nothing less. And anything else which is offered, we will describe as incredible. And if necessary, we'll set up our own independent international inquiry into the crime. In any case, there's going to be many, many court cases. For those of you who don't know, let me tell you that the Emir of Qatar, one of the richest men in the world, has announced that he will pay for every legal action in every court in the world to get compensation for the losses of life and property on the Marmara. And those losses run into billions of dollars. They run into billions of dollars for the dead, the wounded, the falsely imprisoned, and all those people who were robbed, even of their clothes and their travel documents. I really don't have time to say very much more except this, as I announced on Saturday at the demonstration. On the 12th of September, Viva Palestina and our allies, I hope, as last time, the PSC and any other organizations who will join with us as equal partners will set out on an epic land convoy headed for Gaza on the 12th of September. It will travel through Europe and through Turkey and through Syria and through Jordan. And I call now on the government of Egypt to make sure that this convoy, which we intend to be the largest convoy ever to enter Gaza, is allowed safe and swift passage through the gates of Rafah. Secondly, at the same time, organized by the International Committee to Break the Siege on Gaza, which is the umbrella organization which encompasses all or virtually all of the organizations involved in this recent flotilla, will begin to sail from port to port in the Mediterranean, gathering not six ships, but 60 ships for a flotilla that will break the siege of Gaza. And so, both these convoys will arrive at the border of Gaza, sea and land, at the same time, and enter together. If the siege has been lifted by then it will be a victory celebration. If it hasn't been lifted by then if you think the world's got problems over an attack on six ships, wait till you see what happens when the Israeli Navy has to attack 60 ships in the Mediterranean Sea. Lastly, the leaders of the IHH, Chairman Bulent, Nahlan, Sister Nahlan, and all the leaders of the IHH will be at our Summer University of Palestine on the 25th of July in the Bekaa Valley in Lebanon. If you want to come, go to the website vivapalestina.org. I salute all the organizations represented here this evening, all the heroes of the flotilla, and all of you who've come here to show your solidarity with them. Wassalamu alaikum. Thank you very much indeed.